Welcome to Colonial Williamsburg. Last March, my wife and I took one of our annual trips down to Colonial Williamsburg and really toured the town, and in reviewing some of the footage I took, it was obvious that I'm a woodworker, because mostly what I took was architecture and furniture. So rather than trying to cobble together some sort of theme, I figured, here's some scenes from Williamsburg.
It's kind of hard to tell, actually, with this chair that there are eagles on the arms, because they really look kind of snaky. Yeah. But anyway, you've got two in the arm, two up here, and then two around each knee of the leg. So that's eight carved, and then two worked into the negative space back there, which is kind of a neat way to kind of carry that design through. We often think about the claw foot, the ball and claw foot, as being an eagle, but your chair has one there, this sort of thing. And it's almost a surprise that it's not on this chair. You think, eagle, well, where are the talons on this thing? They just look like little snails down there. The scroll foot was actually very fashionable over in England. We didn't do it as much over here. But while this was called an eagle, claw sometimes back then, and more so today. It was originally a Chinese idea. It was a dragon holding a pearl of wisdom and virtue. We start to lose sight of the mythological, basis for this, and start making it look more like things that we're familiar with, but we still love the exotic idea of these Chinese designs. The idea just of having animal forms that worked into furniture is an ancient one. King Tut had one of his thrones had lion's feet carved into it. Still an important thing for us in the 18th century, such an important symbol of power for the English is the lion. So the chair the governor sits in over in the capital, his hairy paw feet, lion's heads terminate the arms. And anybody sitting in a chair with their hands on lion's heads, you could do what they'd say. It'll look pretty powerful. Probably the most interesting chair that this shop made was for the master of a Masonic lodge, and it's just a ceremonial chair, almost like a throne, and all sorts of carving in it, very tall back, and it's got dolphin head feet. You think, okay, having an animal foot on the foot of a leg, that we kind of see where that comes from, but there are these chairs that will have this shape to them. They start to get scaly right about here, and they kind of turn out, and there's a big fish head there with bulging eyes, big open mouth, kind of an interesting design. This is a really unusual walnut with this figure, and we felt like if we oiled it, we might lose too much of the contrast between the lighter parts of this and the darker parts. So we just varnished over this with a raw form of shellac called sea black, and it brought out a more golden look in the walnut. But actually, the wood itself is still fairly dark, and you see down there, it's this longleaf southern pine for all the drawer sides, backs, and bottoms. But if you look at that, it's the natural color of that walnut. So we can kind of control the look a little bit with the finishes.
So the gentleman is walnut.
It's our most important wood in terms of local things. The most fashionable wood is mahogany, like this. That's coming up from the Caribbean. So when you came in to negotiate, or really, let's say, to weigh through the options that you had in a custom piece of furniture, the biggest decision you would make in terms of how the price is going to come out is what wood is going to be. This mahogany desk, actually the original is in walnut, it's over at the DeWitt Wallace Museum. We made ours in mahogany because we already know what it looks like in walnut. Let's see what it would be like if somebody did make that choice to do it in mahogany. And back then, this one would have cost, well, let's say the walnut one would have been about 15% less, something like that. Today, you would not save anywhere near that much by switching between these two woods. It's the 550 hours of work that's going to get you more than anything else. We do use some cherry, not a ton, but we do use some. It doesn't grow as well around here as the walnut does.
How do you begin the build? If you're commissioned to restore a piece, say for the DeWitt Museum, how do you guys start?
Well, and I should first say, we usually don't work on old pieces. We have a conservation lab with conservators behind the scenes that take care of those, and they use every last bit of modern technology, whereas we use every bit of old technology to make new things, so it's kind of the opposite. Where we begin is, let's say there's an old piece in the DeWitt Wallace Museum that we want to copy. We'll go to that piece and obviously make all the measurements that you'd expect us to make. Then we want to try and make sense of those measurements too. How did they design this piece in the first place? What sort of proportioning system were they using? We can't always figure all that out, but it's important for us to try. This way, if there's a part that's been replaced, we can come up with maybe a better replacement part, or occasionally we will design our own stuff, so this gives us a basis for that. The other thing that we do is we look for every last little tool mark that's left behind on the original, because that's our best information about the process employed by the original maker. And that's ultimately what we're after, is to follow the same process. So we treat those old pieces as little crime scenes in a way. You know, we say, well, what happened here 250 years ago? And there are certain, I'm building a desk right now, and there are certain things about the way the original guy did it that just don't make sense. I would never think to do it that way. And then doing them his way, maybe it takes me a little bit longer, but I learn something about his process, and I've got another way to do it in the future if I need to. And there are other things that don't make sense up front, and when you finish it, it still doesn't make sense. If you do it this way.
So how would you determine that? So what's an example of something that he did, and how did you figure out he was doing it different than you with that?
Usually you can see, like, layout lines and... one example, it's kind of hard to explain, but we think about a dovetail joint. You know, by the way, whenever you want to, you're welcome to head into the other two. Captain here. You think of a dovetail joint. That's how we make a box. Whether it's a drawer or the entire chest that the drawers are housed in. And there's a bookcase on top of the desk in the other room. The bottom of the bookcase is raised up from the bottom of the sides, a couple of inches, because there's candle slides that go in this space that slide in, so you have to have room for that. Normally when we do that, we would cut a dado or a groove in the side of this and slide this in from the front, or cut a dovetail shape, we call sliding dovetail there, cut the male member on this piece and you slide it together. It's a really great way to do it. And what this guy did was, and I have no idea why he did it, they did it on all of his bookcases, at least all the half dozen that we still have around. He just made two dovetails like this. Okay. But over something about a foot deep, about 10 inches deep. Just two huge dovetails. Cut these pins in the bottom, only he cut them a couple inches, 2.5 inches deep. And then he took the bottom one and he slid it all the way up there.
This is the bottom shelf for the uppercase?
The bottom shelf of the bookcase. Now, if you think about it, the dovetail is a wonderful joint because it's got this, it's as loose as this one now, as we played with it. It still has a mechanical strength, and I can't pull that off that way. But the arrangement you have is actually not, he's not taking advantage of that. You know, at all. He put books on that, and it's still falling down. So he had to add glue blocks under there to help support it. It took a lot longer to cut these two giant dovetails than the normal way where I should make bigger dovetails there, but maybe 10 or so, or actually I would cut a groove through there or a sliding dovetail. So, you know, why he did it that way, I don't know, and it doesn't necessarily make sense, but since I'm not working to a deadline, it's kind of fun sometimes to do things that don't make sense. I was hoping maybe in doing this some light would go off and I'd say, I know why he did it that way, but I can't say that I do.
Just can't do the grooves.
Yeah, exactly. Well, because he did those elsewhere on the desk. And so in the course of building this desk, I've cut the biggest dovetails I ever had to cut. And then on the interior drawers, Mr. Lockton in the other room can show you these if you ask, but the dovetails smaller than those. So I think the smallest ones I've ever cut and the biggest ones I ever cut, you know, on the same piece. But by the way, this secret drawer hidden
in
there.
Do you know who the original maker of that piece is?
Yeah.
The one that I'm working on now in the other room was made by Peter Scott.
Really?
Who was a guy that, he didn't sign it, so we think it was made by Peter Scott.
But it wasn't like an apprentice or something that, I'm thinking, here's a guy who made a mistake and thought, no one will ever see this, and here you are duplicating it.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, we do see things that are like that all the time, and it's fun to look at old pieces and see their mistakes and how they deal with them.
Yeah. You know,
but he did all of his book cases like that. So it can't have been a mistake. There is, the way the interior drawers are done, they're all done the same except for one corner is different. I don't know if it was done by somebody else in the shop or if it was, if he did it that way first and then realized, well, this other way would be better. You just can't explain that. But Peter Scott worked across the street from the church here in town, and he worked here from 1722 until his death in 1775. He was trained over in England. So he's working in the trade until he was 81, which is pretty amazing in any time period. The reason we can attribute all of these things to Peter Scott is because he was renting the shop space from the Custis family, Jennifer Custis. Jennifer Custis dies, Martha marries George Washington. And Washington kept meticulous records of it. And there are a pair of bureau tables made by him that I think we still have the receipt from the Custis family, you know, that purchased these bureau tables as basically a rent payment for so many months for the shop. And the construction techniques are similar enough on these bureau tables that you can tell that the same shop that made those made these, this handful of desks. You don't have those giant dovetails, but there are a lot of other things there that show the same thing. But the chair you're sitting in, if you came in 10 years ago, we would have told you that that was made by Peter Scott. And now we think that it was made by Robert Walker in Fredericksburg. So this whole group, there's a whole group of chairs that was attributed to Peter Scott that we now attribute to Robert Walker. So at least we think they got that part right. These are all made by the same person. But
the family of John Wentworth, who was the last royal governor of New Hampshire, actually, we don't know that this suite of pieces belonged to Governor Wentworth or to his brother-in-law, his sister, brother-in-law's family. There were a couple triple-back settees, imagine three backs like this built into the back of the settee and some sitting stools. We're intrigued with the Orient throughout the 18th century, and we see all sorts of wonderful, well, the call foot. We borrow the idea of a call clasping a ball from Ming Dynasty China, and the cabriole leg. He's one of the two fellows that made the cradle spin next door, and he's preparing to nail and glue the spine onto the frame of the spinet here. But Ed will take this all the way through. This thing will be strung up, tuned, and playing for a while before it leaves the shop. Actually, the planes, even in that day, would have been the product of professional plane maker. Saws were made by saw makers. There were file and rasp makers, edge tool makers. Blacksmiths generally didn't even make chisels. Blacksmiths work iron. This was something I didn't realize. Blacksmiths work iron, but wherever you have a steel edge laminated onto that iron shank, then you get into another trade. That's the edge tool makers of the cover. This shop was described as a large cabin maker shop with timber yard. So we think there was some kind of a sawing facility behind the shop, but the folks manning that pit saw are not cabin makers or sawyers. That's not in our job description portion. That's a killer word, the key on the end of a pit saw. And most of it was manually cut. We do see them on the fall line of Virginia.
Kind of team effort. The big jobs can't really be done by one person because we'd never be able to make a factory. So we'll make use of what skills are available. Even sets of chairs will likely be a collaboration to not just that one person does the chair, one person does the carving, or if there is carving, but even just getting stuff done. Now, since our shop at one point did offer the making of a harpsichord, we're not exactly sure what's going on with that. how a shop was set up to be able to put on such an offer. Did they have specialists? Did somebody on the crew have some cross training? All of those are very possible scenarios.
How do you do the measurements for the bend? I see the bend.
Okay, I've got a bending form on the mantle here with the removable slats in the top edge, so that basically when I work out a curve, I can cut those slats to conform to it. Then the walnut in this instance, so the actual size, was boiled in hot water for a couple of hours to soften up the fibers, and then immediately it goes from the water into the form and worked in place. That seems to be the way the harpsichord shops actually handle it. I mean, we have steaming boxes, I mean steaming apparatuses at the time. The only ones that I've seen any descriptions of are ones that were used in the shipyards for bending the big planking that's going to be doing hull covers. And these are pretty elaborate affairs. I can't imagine, for a shipyard, I can imagine it because they're doing bulk amounts of work constantly like that. For bending 12 or 15 bend sides in a year, this is more of a problem. In which case, you can find some businesses that just deliberately find a low-tech method of solving the problem.
So there you go, just a little bit of a peek inside the Anthony Hay cabinet shop. Learned a lot while we were there. Stopped by the shoemaker and just couldn't take my eyes off this little corner cabinet made out of longleaf pine. Somehow think this is going to end up on my workbench pretty soon. So I think I'll leave you with some more images from Williamsburg.